My brothers and sisters, several issues we need to speak about. Firstly, the Ummah is bleeding. If you don't sense that the Ummah is bleeding, perhaps you are not a strong member of the Ummah. Maybe more needs to happen for us to recognize and realize who exactly we are. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has taught us that despite what differences we may have, the Ummah is an Ummah. Even when he spoke about the 73 different sects within the Ummah, he says, سَتَفْتَرِقُ أُمَّتِي عَلَىٰ 73 فِرْقَةٍ. He says, my Ummah will be divided into 73 groups. Notice he said, my Ummah, which means 73 groups from his Ummah. What happens with us is shaitan comes to us to make us think, well, this guy belongs to a different sect. This guy has a few differences with me in the way he reads salah. This guy in a few things he believes. Therefore, we do not belong all to the same ummah and we don't need to worry about each other. This is exactly what shaitan wants and the kuffar want. And that's where they've gotten a lot of us. I am here to tell you that come what may, bottom line, you are my brother. You are my sister. I would give my life to defend yours. May Allah Almighty help us. Bottom line is we belong to the ummah of La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We pray 5 times a day. We say the same shahada. We face the same qibla. We believe in hajj in the same place. We do umrah and so much more that we do have in common. Yes, there are differences. I'm not saying downplay them, but I am saying there are issues that affect us as an ummah. We are one ummah when it comes to tackling those issues. May Allah Almighty grant us that goodness, understanding, and the unity amongst us to be able to defend one another. وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْضٍ إِلَّا تَفْعَلُوهُ تَكُنْ فِتْنَةٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَفَسَادٌ كَبِيرٌ. Allah says, the disbelievers will all stand up for one another and be the protectors of one another. If you are not going to do the same, O Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then there will be chaos and corruption of a great stance on earth. A lot of chaos and corruption will overtake the world. Why? Because you are not standing up for one another. Allah says, the kuffar protect one another. If you're not going to do that, there's going to be a problem. Simple. Listen to the verse again. وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْضٍ إِلَّا تَفْعَلُوهُ تَكُنْ فِتْنَةٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَفَسَادٌ كَبِيرٌ. That's Allah. He's guiding us to say, do you want to live in goodness? You are going to need to stand up for one another. The difficulty is, we feel at times because of shaitan's plot that we are divided into minute groups. Each one thinks he's the only Muslim. Each one thinks his group is the only little group. That's where we are failing. And that's why when the enemy attacks, what does he do? He makes you believe, don't worry, I'm attacking these guys on your behalf. Relax, when we finish with them, everything will be okay. When they finish with those, they come for you. And then they tell the others that, you know what, we're just dealing with these guys on your behalf. As it is, you guys don't get along, we're going to sort them out. Wallahi, my brothers, my sisters. It happens in our societies, our communities, and even within one masjid on the different levels. Sometimes we feel, I don't like this guy, this little group, I don't like these people. Why? Born out of maybe a legit difference of opinion or maybe just jealousy. Let's never allow this to happen. Look at what's happening in Gaza. The Ummah is bleeding, not just in Gaza. Look at what they did to Afghanistan. They destroyed it to smithereens. Look at what they did to Iraq. They destroyed it to smithereens. Look at what they did to Libya. They finished it up completely. Look at what they did to Syria. They finished it up totally. Look at what they've done all over the show, one by one. Wallahi, if we stood up as an Ummah, nobody would dare touch us. Look at what they did to Somalia. I come to this area, and one thing I must tell you, the ladies, the sisters from Somalia are definitely role models for us in the sense that our children, our girls and our women need to learn a lesson that how far these people came from out of the difficulty that they faced. They did not give up their hijab. Subhanallah. Today I wanted to speak a little bit about the holiday that we're all in at the moment or about to enter. You are on holiday. Your salah is not on holiday. You are on holiday. Your hijab is not on holiday. You are on holiday. Your halal food is not on holiday. You are on holiday. Your abstention from haram is not on holiday. You are on holiday. You cannot compromise your deen thinking, I'm on holiday. People say, well, I only ate at a halal friendly place. That's all. Was it certified? Did you make sure? No, it was halal friendly. My brothers and sisters, the Muslims themselves sometimes do not know exactly how to verify what is halal and haram. How can you leave that for the kuffar to determine? Halal friendly. Do you know, according to them? And I've been to ask people this, what's going on? They say, well, the meat is sourced from a halal place. Even if I believed that, what about the ingredients? They said, what ingredients? They don't even know you got to look at the ingredients. Meat sourced from a halal place. I don't deny that. Perhaps it is. How did you cook it? Well, you know, we just put it into this wok and we made it. And what else did you put into it? Well, we put in anything and everything, but it's halal friendly because I promise you, the guys who give us the meat, it's halal. My brother, you cooked it in the same pot as the bacon and the pork and whatever else it was. Number two is all the haram stuff that you had there. Everything is there. Number three, you put in the wines and the whiskies and the champagnes to enhance the taste accordingly. You're calling it halal friendly. And here we are, Muslims who fulfill their salah. And they say, but I ate at a halal friendly place. My brother, it means may Allah protect us. I'm only saying this in order to tell you the ummah is bleeding and you're worried about a piece of meat and you want to eat it. In our language, you want to chow it by hook or crook. Come on, the ummah's bleeding. Can't you give up a little plate of food in order to save your iman? No wonder why you don't really care for the rest of the ummah, because what you're consuming is haram. How will Allah answer your dua? How will Allah answer your dua when your food is haram, your clothing is haram, your drink is haram, the way you behave is haram? If you were to be resurrected, you would be resurrected with idiots on the day of Qiyamah. Do you really think you're going to be resurrected with Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Look at what you look like. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam clearly tells us you'll be resurrected with your circle, your people, those around you. That's who you're going to be resurrected with. Ask yourself, look in the mirror, where do I fit in? Do you fit in with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahaba and Sahabiyat? Or do you fit in with the rest of the people who were at the club last night drinking and drugging? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. We have to solve the problems of the ummah. Be hard on yourself. Be hard on yourself. Come for Fajr. Make sure that you fulfill your five salah. Learn to make changes in your life that will identify you as a member of the ummah. Because when you die later today, when you die, you will be resurrected with the same group that you associated with, that you looked like, that you were around. So be careful whom you associate with, who you mimic, who you follow, and so on. Be hard on yourself. Here's the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam speaking about a man. He is tired, he is perhaps not even dressed properly, and he's really struggling and he's calling out to Allah, Ya Rabbi, Ya Rabb, oh my Lord, oh my Lord. But malbasuhu haram, mashrabuhu haram, ghudhiya bil haram, fa anna yustajabu lidhalik. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, the man's food is haram, his clothing is haram, his drink is haram. How does he expect Allah to answer him? Still, out of the mercy of Allah, Allah gives us. Today I'm emotional, and rightly so. Our brothers and sisters are dying without anyone able to do a thing. And those killing them are proud of what they are doing. And here we are seated here, and we can't even decide whether or not to eat at a halal friendly place without knowing exactly what it is. I'm not saying that every place is halal or haram. All I'm telling you, be very careful with what you put in your mouth. It could determine, listen to this, the sweetness of your act of worship or the bitterness of it. What does that mean? When I derive energy from a haram source, that energy cannot be used to worship Allah. It's impossible. It will be used to energize me to do haram. So you're wondering, why am I inclined to pornography, to haram, to adultery, to maybe alcohol, to gambling? Why am I so inclined to all of that? And I can't even find the energy to leave those things. The reason is your root is haram. The energy you derive from a haram. So something you're doing in your system is totally upside down. That's what it is. I'm emotional because it's about time the ummah realized, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. Allah will not change the condition of an ummah until they change themselves, each one of them. It is part of the solution. It sounds like a fairy tale, doesn't it? But we can only derive our strength from our togetherness. We're all supposed to be steadfast. My brothers and sisters, today is the day. Today is the day. Do you know that a public holiday was declared simply because people knew how to kick a ball? Do you know that? People knew how to kick a ball, so a public holiday was declared. For us, well and good, mashallah. We are here in the masjid listening to one message, the message of Allah and His Rasul, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What is the message? Please do yourselves a favor. I should also do myself a favor. Today I promise Allah, oh Allah, I'm going to be a stronger and better Muslim. I'm going to identify as a Muslim. I'm going to be proud of my Islamic identity. I'm going to walk towards goodness. I'm going to become strong so that I can quit my sin. These are the type of promises I need to make. People look forward to the end of the year. I've spoken to so many business people. They say, you know what, I need a break. I know you need a break, but does that mean your salah should be on break? Does that mean your hijab suddenly goes on break? Does that mean your consciousness of halal and haram goes on break? You say, I worked the whole year, I struggled the whole year, now I must go on a break. Mashallah, it's fair and good. Go to a place where at least your salah is in order. Go to a place where at least you have halal food or take it with you. Go to a place where you don't need to compromise your shame. Allahu Akbar. Go to a place where you don't need to compromise your hijab. Go to a place where Allah will be pleased with you. Why don't you decide to go to Umrah and to go to a blessed place, a blessed land, perhaps somewhere that you can teach your family and children more about the deen of Allah. Something historic. Look, these were our heroes and heroines. These are the people whom we should be following. This is what they did. These are the sacrifices they made. Imagine visiting where Badr took place and telling your children, this is the known as Jabalul Malaika, the mount where the angels came down to assist 313 people to overcome an army of 1,000 who were heavily armed.